And then Rob, our new sound system fellow, et cetera, is homesick too.
Oh, geez.
So that just happened this morning. So we're kind of waiting it, but you know, it's a wait and a prayer, and this is great. So we usually have Zoom. We are not having a Zoom service, but Jeanette just got the live stream going. So the service will be live streamed for people who can watch it from home. They just won't be able to participate in Zoom. You can explain that to me, but I won't get it all, but I know that it's being recorded and people can view it. We just won't have the live participation of Zoom. Even though we had Sandy Lewis right there to be our Zoom deacon and all set up for exchange. So anyway, that's the way it is today. We have with us Pastor Sue Davidson, who served the Center Conway Methodist Church for over 20 years, retired last year from that. Busy lady. She also had a full-time job at Saco River Medical Group, but retired from those things, so now she is on the board of the Way Station. She is the hospice chaplain for visiting nurse services, and she participates actively with the clergy of this valley. She's one of those pastors that Gail is always talking about, the ministers who do this and this and this. Pastor Sue is one of those people who always raises her hand, and she's in the room. So we're very happy to have her with us today. Big announcement is that next Sunday, directly following our service, it's going to be a community barbecue here at the church right after service. So, you know, this is barbecue season, so next Sunday is that. And Gail will, of course, be sending out emails. I think we'll be sending out emails this week to let you know what you should bring, how you can help. More hands the merrier. But it will be next Sunday for sure. And we're all going to pray for great weather. Bring friends. It's open to anybody. You're welcome to bring lots of people. We always have more food than we need, so bring a friend. Does anybody else have any announcements for the life of the church or the community that they want us to speak of today?
I'll say for the community, the Bartlett Library is using the Congregational Church corner near Notch Road and having a huge book sale tomorrow from 9 to 1, and like the paperbacks are $4 and the hardbacks are $1, and there's tons of interesting books.
Okay. So then the Bartlett Parade is going to be 11 o'clock, so they're welcoming you to go to the book sale before the parade, after the parade.
And the Historical Society has an open house 10 to 2, so you can see the new building there, the museum, they're trying to put a new old Catholic church.
Okay. So Bartlett Village is going to be a place to be in the morning. I think the Conway Parade is at 1 in the afternoon tomorrow, so lots happening. And hopefully nobody missed the fireworks in Jackson last night, which were brief but gorgeous. Really, really nice. So if there aren't any other announcements, I'm sorry we can't get Zoom announcements today, but hopefully everything has been online for folks. Then I'm going to turn this over to Pastor Sue to center us and lead us in our call to worship.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
So, this is the deal. I won't use the mic unless you put up your hand and say, I can't hear you. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Meg, for the lovely introduction. I am a licensed local pastor in the United Methodist tradition. And as she said, I was appointed. We do an appointing system within the United Methodist Church, not a call system, at the church in Center Conway for just 20 years. And retired a year ago next Sunday. So, but as God is always calling us into something new and exciting, that's how I ended up in hospice work. So it is good to be with you. So I ask you to just take a deep breath and center your hearts and minds as we come to worship. There's a spirit of love in this place. There's a spirit of love in this place. You can't see it, but it's there, just as precious is the air. There's a spirit of love in this place. Let's join together in the call to worship. Holy Comforter,
you
Ben, Ron, Ellen, Mary Claire, Sue, Sasha, Richard, Sean, Tom, Barry, Jan, Kathy, Alexis, Keith, all their families, their caregivers, and their loved ones. We want to hold in prayer those who are recovering from procedures, those who are struggling with COVID, new or old, those who are living with cancer, with cognitive changes, with mental health challenges. We especially think of Kevin. Chronic, life-limiting illnesses. We think of those who are on hospice and their families. We think of those who are grieving. We also remember in prayer our partners in the Chikanga Church in the city of Mutare in Zimbabwe. We remember our friends in Honduras in the villages of Plan Grande and San Jose who are making their way in a post-COVID world and things are getting better. And we think of those all over the world with disasters and wars, too many to enumerate. We think of people facing transitions of all kinds. Is there anybody here who has a concern that you would like to raise and have us remember in prayer? Cheryl, speak up.
Prayers.
Open up some behavior.
Prayers for safe travels for people.
Safe travels for people. Speaking especially.
Prayers for the little fawn who was taken down by a bobcat in our neighborhood. The poor little thing was only a week old, and we're quite sad about it. So prayers that the little thing didn't suffer.
Is there anyone else who has a prayer concern that you'd like to raise with us? And as always, we want to follow our concerns with things that have given us joy and things for which we are grateful. Life does seem to balance. God gives us ways to handle things, I think. Does anybody have a joy they want to mention or something beautiful they saw this week?
Yes. Lots to celebrate. Thank you. But we watched the fireworks from our deck last night with my whole family, and it was a lot of fun. It was short and sweet and really great.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm grateful for the beautiful things that our little village makes so easy to enjoy. You look out your window, you sit on your deck like Cheryl did, you sit on your porch like Wendy did, and just drive down the hill like we did. It was so nice to see the village gathered like that. I guess I'm grateful for the little bear that showed up next to my seat in the kitchen a few days ago. I was sitting at my kitchen table, and all of a sudden I heard this scratch on the siding and looked, and there were four fingers right over the edge of the window next to me. I realized it was a bear grabbing onto the window sill. While it scared me to death, I thought, wow, it's so nice, it looks so close to nature. And he scared right away. It was creepy, but awesome, you know?
We
scared each other. And I knew the window was closed, but the outside still was there. I just saw these fingers go over the edge. So, you know, and now I'm having the pleasure of repeating and thinking about that for a long time. We are glad that we can hold, happy that we can be together and hold people and situations in prayer. And we are happy that there are things that God gives us to make that we can be grateful for and happy about. So let us join together and say the prayer of the Lord to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, let's see how well we can sing, huh? We're going to turn to page 515. You may stand if you feel like you would like to, otherwise sit with gusto. This is my song. Love has show his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world, that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he is in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. Because in this world, we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command. Whoever loves God must also love his brother. The reading from 1 John. I hope you noticed how many times the word love appeared in that text. I'm also going to be reading this morning from the Gospel of Matthew. And it's in the 10th chapter, but I think it's important to set the scene of this text before I begin. Jesus had been instructing his disciples and teaching them, and then he sends them out. He sends 12 disciples out to tell their story and to witness to what Jesus has been teaching. He actually called them harvest hands, and they were to be about bringing the good news to the people in all the towns and villages. He had given them detailed instructions of what to do if their message is heard, but he also gave them detailed instructions of what to do if their message was unheard. He had advised them to travel light, lodge modestly, and eat only what you need. So he said, go to the lost, confused people right here in the neighborhood. Tell them that the kingdom of God is near. Bring health to the sick. Raise the dead. Touch the untouchables. Kick out the demons. And Jesus continues to tell them that it's not easy work, but actually could be hazardous. But then he gives them the reassurance. So I begin reading from the 10th chapter of Matthew, in the 38th verse. And this is from Eugene Peterson's The Message, which is a paraphrase, not a translation. And Jesus says, if you don't go all the way with me through thick and thin, you don't deserve me. If your first concern is to look after yourself, you'll never find yourself. But if you forget about yourself and look to me, you'll find both yourself and me. We are intimately linked in this harvest work. Anyone who accepts what you do accepts me, the one who sent you. Anyone who accepts what I do accepts my Father who sent me. Accepting a messenger of God is as good as being God's messenger. Accepting someone's help is as good as giving someone help. This is a large work I've called you into, but don't be overwhelmed by it. It's best to start small. Give a cool cup of water to someone who is thirsty, for instance. The smallest act of giving me makes you a true apprentice. You won't lose out on the thing. And give thanks for these three scripture lessons for us this morning. So this is one of those Sundays that always befuddles me. Now, I'm not that I'm easily befuddled, but it's summer, it's hot, it's a holiday weekend, and it is time to worship. And while July 4th is tomorrow, it's Independence Day, it's not a religious holiday like Christmas or Easter or Trinity Sunday or any of those religious holidays that we celebrate. But it is, however, a significant day in the history of the American people and the tenets upon which this nation was founded. This morning I've chosen to share with you scriptures about God's love for us and the work that we as followers and leaders of faith are called to be a part of. I like to use the term fears, not because it's not just about the doing. It's about being in faith and doing in faith. They go together. So I invite you to pray with me. Oh, gracious and loving God, we come this morning as the people of God gathered in community yet again. Some watching by live stream and others wishing that they could be on Zoom or here. But Lord, here we are. May the meditations of my mouth and all of us be together. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, the Rock, the Redeemer. Amen. It is clear to me that in the 250 plus years since the Declaration of Independence was signed, much has happened. Amen. Wars have been fought and are still being fought. Riots have been incited. People have marched in the streets of cities and towns for whatever cause that they feel that marching needs to be. They've rallied behind various political figures. Passionate leaders have emerged, all because the founding fathers envisioned a nation where all are created equal, given by their creator certain rights. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, taken directly from the phrase in the Declaration of Independence. It raises the question for me, what does it mean to be free? There has been much risk and struggling by our foremothers and forefathers for us to have the lives that you and I experience today. So what is the so what for us as people who have freedom to be? Freedom to be here in the sanctuary. One of the things that Jesus made clear in the Gospels is that love is the standard. And that was carried over in the later books of the New Testament, like I read from 1 John. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, Jesus said. The text from 1 John is all about his love, which Jesus did more than hint about during his own ministry. In these 15 verses in 1 John, there are 20-ish reference to God's love for us and how that love was shown through Christ. Love and freedom. Loving all people means that we are committed to fight for the freedom of everyone, not just our own being, and not necessarily with guns and weapons, but with love. We can do this every day in our personal lives by being in the mind of Christ, which leads us to love one another and treat one another with love and respect. Yes, there is something special about this weekend. It's about family and picnics and fireworks and strawberry shortcake and, you know, whatever it is that is a tradition in your own life. But it is also a day to celebrate the freedom that we have in Christ and to live our lives as the image of God. May I never again be defiled about the relationship between this holiday and my own faith. share communion on the first Sunday of the month. As I indicated, I am a licensed local pastor within the United Methodist Tradition, and I can only officiate communion within the appointment in which I serve, which means that for me, that's within the hospice community. So today I'm going to share with you another tradition that was introduced by the founder of the Methodist movement, John Wesley. John Wesley called it the love feast. It is not intended to be communion or to be like communion. And for those who are watching on live stream and wish to participate, you should find a glass of water and a piece of bread or a cracker. Although the origins of the love feast in the early church are closely interconnected with the origins of the Lord's Supper, the two services became quite distinct and should not be confused with each other. The love feast has appeared only at certain times and among certain denominations. So John Wesley first experienced a love feast when he encountered the German Moravians while he was in Savannah, Georgia. John Wesley had a really tough time while he was in Savannah, Georgia, and he was looking for something to feed his spirit, and he hooked up with the Moravians. It was a service of prayer. It was a service of sharing food. It was a service of religious conversation, and it included testimonies to the movement of the Holy Spirit and the way God was working in the lives of those seated at the table, and also how love had been shown to the individual, and of course they sang. It quickly became a feature of the evangelical revival and a regular part of the Methodist society meetings. As the Methodist movement came to America, they did not have ordained pastors to serve communion, so they used the love feast as a way of gathering at the table and giving thanks. As I said, it's not intended to replace communion, but it's a way to share at the table when there's no officiant, or if there is a desire to be more informal and spontaneous. And we are spontaneous this morning, aren't we? So sharing in this love feast allows for those of different denominations or faith backgrounds to share at a table of grace, love, joy, and peace. How many times did we read in Scripture that Jesus did his best work seated around the table? Think about that. He did his best work when he was seated around the table. The Scripture that I shared from Matthew this morning is one that I feel offers us gathering the opportunity to see what Jesus was teaching about the role of us to love one another. So, our tradition at home is to always sing grace before we come to the table. So, this is John Wesley's grace, and if you know it, you may sing along. Be present at our table, Lord. Be here and everywhere adored. Thy creatures bless and grant that we make peace and paradise with thee. Amen. So this morning we're going to share at the table with bread, gluten-free, and water.
This word.
The scripture from Matthew says he sent them out, and what did he tell them to do? He told them to give a cool cup of water to someone. Start small. So we're starting small this morning, and we will have a cool drink of water and a piece of bread to remind us that when we gather at any table, that it is God's table. And like I said, it's a table of love, joy, grace, and peace. Amen? So, I just happened to bring cold water this morning. Surprise, surprise. Little bottles of cold water. So, this is how we'll do this. I will just invite invite you to come as you wish. If you wish to stop at the table, you may do that. And there is a basket of food. And very carefully, do you have them to each pick up their own, or do you give it to them?
We pick up.
Pick your own? Okay. And I'm just going to leave them right here. And I'm going to let you come. If you wish to stop and give thanks at the table, you may do that out loud and say, today I give thanks for seeing a fawn, even though it was captured by something else. Or seeing the claws of the bear. Or the deer that have eaten all my lily bulbs, or lily blossoms. Every single oriental lily. Oh. So I give thanks for the deer that he's well fed. Amen. I give thanks for grandchildren that are lovely young adults.
So, I'd like to just make one comment that I think is relevant. You know, when people pray, we can pray for everybody, because if they're doing things that aren't proper, we pray to them as they are born. And if we pray to them as they're born, they are viewing the perfect form. And then we just simply say, Jesus, will you take care of the rest? Of the grace of God.
What a great testimony that is. Amen. So, as we share with the bread, we thank the Creator for the daily bread, for the food which delights and nourishes us, and for the companionship that sustains us. As we share in this water, we give thanks that we are able to quench our thirst, and for the living water with which God surprises us and enriches us and transforms us every single day. So come ahead. It is a love feast prepared for each of you. Tomorrow. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. you have sung so well today. Guess what? You get to sing again. I was telling someone earlier that John Wesley's directions for singing that's in the front of the United Methodist hymnal, one of them says, sing lustfully as not to embarrass yourself. So we're going to sing lustfully as not to embarrass ourselves, and we're going to sing hymn 68, which is Bless You to Tie That Bond.
One of the songs that I went.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. This just had a heavy kind of hymnal. I'm going to teach more songs and say I'm here.
That's okay. That's okay. I love, you know, Charles Wesley, the great hymn writer. There's hundreds of hymns. And do you know his hymns were written to the tunes of bar tunes? Because that's what the people of the time knew. So you put Jesus' words, the bar tunes, and you've got great hymns. Yeah. Bless be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The fellowship of kindred minds is like to that of love. Before the gracious throne, we pour our heart in prayers. Our fears are goals, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. We share each other's woes, each other's burdens bear, and often for each other close, a sympathizing tear. When we are called to come, if you is a sinner thing, the good shall sit against your heart, and the Lord shall be again. There's a presence of peace in this room. There's a presence of peace in this room. In God's tenderness is peace that passes human bounds. There's a presence of peace in this room. Oh God, of fireworks and good works, bless us this day as we go from this place. May our celebrations be joyous, may they be memorable, and may our service to others reflect your love, your joy, your grace, and your peace. Go in peace, my friends, and may the peace of God be with each of you. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.